Wow.
Man, I'm thankful for our worship team, aren't you? My goodness. Wow. Wow. Wow, wow. I never regret time spent with the Lord's people in the Lord's house, and just sweet the way he's leading us forward. I got to tell you, I'm super encouraged. I'm watching you guys. I'm watching our church family, and I just see you leaning into the Lord, and that's what it's all about. It has honestly been so encouraging. Our staff has been talking about this. We have watched fired up worship, and if you weren't here last week, sorry for you, but like it was unbelievable, just our people responding to the Lord in worship, and I'm watching people lean into authentic community, and just we have to like kick them out after church, like go home, it's time to go home now. No, I'm just kidding. You stay all day. I love that. Relationships matter. We're doing this together. Take care of each other. Pray for each other. It's beautiful. I'm seeing, yeah, you want to clap? That's great. Awesome. Yeah. And I'm really watching just super selfless and fervent service to the Lord. If you know anyone who served at High Five this week, go up to them very gently and just say, thank you so much, because they're exhausted. They don't want to hear much more than that. But our people, we had over, I heard we had close to 300 volunteers this week caring for a bunch of kids, pointing them all to Jesus Christ. And I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm super thankful for all of those things. Yeah, let's praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah. We have a lot to be thankful for. And so with that, we're turning the corner. Do you know we're into summer? Friday was the first of summer, and I looked at the forecast this week and saw some eights in that, the temperatures. I like that. It was the first number, not the second number, so that's really great. Love it. Summer's here, and with that, we've been praying and thinking about what does the Lord have for our church? Where should we be in his word? What are the themes? What are the things? And a bunch of our pastors got together. We've been praying and talking and considering. Dave Stone joined us in that, and we have come up with this theme that I believe is the Lord's theme for us for this summer, and we're going to go with this. The theme for the summer of our messages is unsung, everyday people, uncommon faith, okay? Unsung, everyday people, uncommon faith. And I got to say, I'm looking around, y'all look pretty good for a Sunday morning, but we're a bunch of very everyday people. I'm a very everyday person, and so are you. Nothing special, nothing particularly unique, but we have this. We have faith in the living God. And everyday people living out an uncommon faith can be used in incredible ways for God's agenda. So that's where we're going this summer. And what we're going to do is not so much pick out the Hall of Fame, you know, faith people in the Bible, but the people you might not have remembered their story, or you might not have thought about that in a while, but how very common people lived out extraordinary faith for the God that they worship and serve. I can't wait. It's going to be great. So in kicking that off, we thought, well, where do we start? And we said, we need to start with faith itself. What is faith, and how does it work in our lives? And so today, we chose to go to Hebrews chapter 11. And if you know scripture a little bit, like that's a common choice when you start talking about faith. Interestingly, 19 times in Hebrews chapter 11, the word faith comes up. 19 times. And by faith and through faith, and it's all about faith. Some people have called Hebrews chapter 11 the Hall of Faith. Do you know this? Not the Hall of Fame, but like the Hall of Faith, because you read about what God did through Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and Moses and on and on. The Hall of Faith. And here's what I want to tell you about that. I believe those aren't amazing people. I think those are common people with an amazing God and an uncommon faith. So this morning, we're going to dive into Hebrews chapter 11, the first three verses. Really helpful and important to get the context that the book of Hebrews is written to a group of people you could call messianic Jews, okay? So these are people who, they were Jewish, they were part of God's promise, God's chosen people, and they understood his promises, and they looked forward to and prayed for and longed for the arrival of the Messiah who had been promised. And what's amazing is for the Hebrews, the readers of Hebrews, they were messianic Jews, which means they had now seen that promise fulfilled through Jesus Christ, the promised Messiah. So Hebrews is rich and full with references to the Old Testament and references to what God had revealed previously and how it is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. That's who this is written to. And that's really important to understand so that we understand some of the context of what's happening. So I want to read these verses, then I want to ask the Lord to lead our time, and we're going to jump into this together. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it, the people of old received their commendation. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. Let's pray together. Lord, we're holding now your word, and we recognize its authority. We recognize how important it is that we yield to you, that we would listen to you. Lord, would you lead us now and give us insight, not just understanding, but the ability to respond to you now by faith. We love you. We thank you. You've met with us again today, Lord. It is our joy and our privilege, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So the title of the message today is this: The Impact of Persevering Faith. The impact of persevering faith. I don't know about you. I want my life to have an impact. I don't want to just mark off time. I don't want to just do things and then die. I want my life to have an impact, primarily an impact for the Lord, that other people know him, that other people are drawn closer to him. And I know you guys well enough to know you want that too. I don't want to just mark time. I want to be used and impactful for the Lord. So as we look at God's word together today, all of that is under this heading of impact of persevering faith. If you're a note taker, let me give you the first one. We'll get started. Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Okay? Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Let's look again at verse 1. What does it say? Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. I would say that Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 is one of the best descriptions of faith you'll find anywhere in Scripture. It's clear. It's simple. I understand this. Faith is the assurance, the confidence of things hoped for. And it's the conviction of things not seen, okay? Now, I want to just break this down one step farther, and I want to take the word faith and just give you a couple of, I think, two things I see within it, because I want to be really clear. What are we talking about, faith? I see two aspects, two parts of faith, and here's the first word, belief. Belief. Belief is the mental understanding, intellectual understanding, and agreement. I get it. And I believe it's true, okay? Faith requires that you understand what God's word says, what he has revealed, and that you agree that it's true, okay? That's the belief part. So there's another part, not just belief, but the second word is this, trust, trust. I can believe a lot of things, but I don't always press down on it and obey. I don't always follow through and show that I believe by the way I behave and by the way I choose. And I don't know you, I know many of you, but I don't know what you think. I've talked to many people who say, you know, faith is hard for me. It's hard for me to put my faith maybe in anyone or anything. And I just want to press your thinking a little bit on that topic. So I was thinking about this. I am curious how many of you in here rode in a car this week. Anybody? Yeah, that's what I thought. And me too. And I... my car, maybe yours is like this, has a pedal on the right, and when I press it, the car goes faster. Is your car like this? And then it's got one on the left, and when I press that at the appropriate time, I slow down and even stop. It's really a great process. Now, I gotta say, I was thinking about this. Every time I do that, I'm exercising faith. I have not once pulled out the schematics of how the brake system is designed and looked and said, does this make sense? Is this logical? Is that the right design? You know, I don't check the fluid or the pads or whatever the parts of the cars are every time I drive. I don't. There's an element of faith. It's going to do what it's supposed to do. I'm putting my trust in it. I, this week, drove over a bridge. Did I check with the county that had been inspected? Did I get under it and kind of look and see? No, I put my faith. I'm like, I'm going. Here we go. Worked out great. Some of you, anybody been in an elevator? How does that work? I know there are answers to these questions, but there's just things I think about. And talk about faith. I'm on what floor? 80 what? And we put our faith in things all the time. I was thinking about the doctor's office. You know, you go to the doctor. I don't know that he went to school. I see the thing on the wall, but I think he did. And then he says, you need this, so go to the pharmacist, because if you take this, you'll be better. Well, I've never even met the pharmacist, and what are you doing back there? What are you putting in that bottle? And I just go home and I just take it. We exercise faith all the time. So I don't think our struggle is the ability to exercise faith. I think our struggle is exercising faith in the God who we can trust. I don't always choose to trust him, but I'm constantly exercising faith. What this word is telling us is that persevering faith is anticipating God's blessing. The question I have for you is just this. Are you choosing to put your faith in God? Are you choosing to put your faith in God and in his son, Jesus Christ? I want to be really clear. I'm not talking about having faith in your faith, you know? Like if I just have enough faith, it'll all be okay. Not that. I mean simple, fundamental, sometimes even weak faith placed in the God who we can trust, okay? Because he does not disappoint. So it's not faith in faith. It's certainly not blind faith. I don't know. I just hope for the best. Are you kidding me? There's actual truth. There's actual revelation of who God is and what he's done. It's not blind for a second unless we're not receiving it. But faith has a source, has a object, and it is the living God. And it's interesting in this passage, it says, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. I talk to lots of people, like, are the Cubs gonna win? I hope so, or not, depending on your bias. Is it gonna be sunny tomorrow? I hope so. You know, is it gonna turn out okay? I hope so. This isn't like that. This isn't a vague sense of I just hope it's all good. This is hope that is standing on the firm foundation of faith in God. So faith is the foundation where hope can be fixed and can stand and can flourish and can grow. It's not vague. It's not unclear. It is based on the reality of who our God is and what he has revealed to ourselves. Now, you might be looking at your notes, and if you're like, David, you said persevering faith. I don't see persevering in that verse. All right, can I show you where we got that? Go back up in Hebrews chapter 10 to verse 32. Now remember, who is this? These are mostly Messianic Jews. These are Jews who looked for, longed for, their families, their generations had longed for the promised Messiah. And then he appeared, okay? And this is the context, Hebrews 10, 32. They're challenged with this. Recall the former days. When after you were enlightened, that's, oh, he's here. Jesus is the Messiah. Their eyes were opened. After you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings. Sometimes it's like that. I just got to be honest with you. If you're going to stand for Christ, you're going to live for him, there's going to be times there is a hard struggle that includes sufferings. Sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction. Sometimes being partners with those so treated. Verse 34, for you had compassion on those in prison and you joyfully accepted, now just read this with me, 34. You had compassion on those in prison and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Lord, I don't care that it costs me personally. I don't care that it costs me financially. I don't care that my property is plundered. What I care about is I'm gonna honor you. I'm gonna put my faith in you. And I have confidence because I got a better deal coming. I'm going to heaven because of Jesus Christ. Whatever I would lose for you here, Lord, is nothing. Verse 36, 5. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. for yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live how? By faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. Man, I love that. Persevering faith anticipates blessing. We're not with the Lord yet. The story's not done yet. We know what is true. We know what is coming. But now we live in this in-between where, Lord, I put my faith in you. I have my hope in you because I know what's going to happen. My faith is going to become sight. I'm going to be with you. I love that. Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Here's a second thing. Persevering faith receives God's approval. Wow, what a concept. That God could look to you, look to me with approval. How can that happen? Well, look at verse 2. It says this, Hebrews 11, verse 2. For by it, what's it? By faith, right? For by it, the people of old received their commendation. Okay, two questions here. Who are the people of old? Is it old people? No, although that could be me. But no, not the people of old. It's people of old. They're talking about Old Testament saints. They're talking about those who, the Jewish believers he was talking to here. They had looked for the promised Messiah for generations and waited and longed for the people of old. That's who that is. What did they receive? They received their commendation, okay? This is God's approval. This is God's favor. How did they receive it? Because they were amazing people. No, by faith, by faith. It's all about faith. Hebrews 11, verse 6 says this, and without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Now just think about this for a second. Without faith, is it hard to please God? Is it challenging to please God? God's word says it is impossible. Don't show me your resume of good works. Don't show me your list of your full calendar of activities. Faith is the response that brings God's approval. And it's not blind faith, it's faith in the God who has revealed himself to us through his son, Jesus Christ. See, these saints, they had a real and responsive faith to what had been revealed to them. They for generations, many generations, did not see the coming of the Messiah. They knew, they looked forward, they prayed, they watched, but they didn't see it. But they were faithful and they had a real response to what had been revealed to them. Now let me ask you this. What has God revealed to you? Has he shown you who he is? Has he shown you the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Has he shown you that you need a Savior and Jesus Christ is the only way? And then I would just ask, have you responded to him by faith? I think it's really important to kind of break this down. We're going to spend a little time on this. I want to talk for a second about three stages of faith, okay? Three stages of faith. And if you're wondering if they all start with the same letter, the answer is yes, okay? Because that's what pastors do. So three stages of faith. First of all, it's this, personal faith, personal faith. I wish I could just take time and sit with each one and say, I want to hear your story of personal faith. We heard Jaron and Daniel in the baptisms today when they trusted Jesus Christ personally. And I would just love for you to tell me, not now, but tell me, when did you trust Jesus Christ personally for the forgiveness of your sins? Because he did something that is so unbelievable. The Bible is so clear that God is holy and perfect and sinless. And it is so clear that I am a sinful person and that all of us sin and all of us fall short of God's glory. And that is a massive problem without hope, except for the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. And then there's every reason for hope. And my simple question about personal faith to you is this. Have you ever placed your faith in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And if as I'm saying that, you're like, is he talking to me? We'd love to talk to you. There's no more important conversation that could be had than to talk about putting your trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior. So, stages of faith, personal faith. Have I trusted him as my Savior? Second stage of faith, particular faith. Particular, or if it didn't have to be a P, you could use the word specific. Okay? Specific faith. Now, what do I mean by that? What I mean is this. My experience has been that since I came to faith in Christ, when I read his word, when I interact with his word, there are very specific and personal things that God calls me to respond to. This is what I'm telling you, Dave. Now you get the decision to act by faith or not on that topic. I'll give you a couple examples. One of them is the topic of forgiveness. Left to myself, in my way of thinking, apart from Christ, I don't want to forgive anyone of anything because you hurt me, because you failed me, because I'm not letting that go. In Christ, God has granted me forgiveness. I don't deserve that. I could never earn that. Thank you, Lord, for the grace that would offer forgiveness. But I'm called now to extend that same forgiveness to those who hurt me. That is a particular instance of faith. I will or I will not trust you, Lord, that that is right. And I will or will not trust you with the outcomes of what happens if I walk in that faith. Forgiveness has been a particular one for me. A second one that's particular I remember is baptism. You know, I got saved probably about this height, but I was 23, 24 years old preparing for ministry, and I had never been baptized. I'm like, how did I miss this? I don't know. But then it was so clear to me, followers of Christ identify with him through baptism. Now I had a problem because I'm like, well, that's for new believers, you know, and that's not me, and maybe it's not, I don't know. But it came down simply to this for me. I will either obey the Lord in that or I will not. And praise God, I did. And with obedience comes blessing and fellowship with the Lord. Specific, particular faith. I'll give you one more. I can remember when Diana and I were newly married. We're coming up on anniversary 22 shortly. But I remember before Quicken and before Every Dollar or whatever app manages your money, we had this thing called a yellow pad. You have one of those? And so we're newly married. We're like, we got to figure out our budget. So, which is a word I've never really liked, I'll be honest. And so we took the piece of paper, and at the top we wrote income. And that didn't take very long to fill that in. And then there was expenses, and the car, and the rent, and the food, and the whatever. And I remember at that same time, God was convicting us, and we were getting good Bible teaching about giving and the importance of tithing and first things to the Lord. And I was like, okay, Diane, there's one problem. If we do that, there's not enough money in the rest of the categories to meet the rest of the needs we listed. And I just remember as clear as anything that we're like, well, we have a choice to make. Will we or will we not trust the Lord in this? And I remember saying, Lord, we're going to trust you. And I could tell you many, many stories of just God's timely provision, his care, his ability to meet the needs. I think we would have missed all of them had we not just said, okay, Lord, we'll obey. Now, those are for me. What are the ones for you? Where are the points of particular obedience where you're like, I know what the Lord's telling me, but it's hard. We have to make decisions of faith because persevering faith receives God's approval. Okay, personal faith, particular faith. Here's the third one, persevering faith. Persevering faith. Now this one, honestly, is hard. It's just flat out hard. I do trust the Lord. I have put my trust in Jesus Christ. I have chosen to obey him at specific points where his word has showed me. But now it's really hard. I am going through a trial. I am in a struggle. It has been painful. I can't believe the disappointment. I'm frustrated by my own failure. We all have these things. And that's where, Lord, help us to find persevering faith. It's choosing to put my faith in God when I'm tempted, just as we read, to shrink back. I want to go back to what I had because I think it's better than what's ahead in Christ. Are you kidding me? We have everything to look forward to in Christ. Persevering faith It refines us, it purifies us, it changes us from the inside out, and it's the bedrock of our faith. It's unshakable. It's unshakable. Why? Because my faith is so awesome. No, because my faith is placed in the God who is so awesome, and he will not fail, and he will not disappoint. Persevere in your faith. We're everyday people, guys. We're just everyday people, but we are going after an uncommon faith, because I know that if we individually and collectively put our trust in our God with uncommon faith, we're going to see him do things we could never imagine. And I see it already. Lord, help us. Lord, help us. Everyday people, uncommon faith. I was reading one commentator, John MacArthur, said this: faith is not simply one way to please God. It is the only way. I understand that, okay? Faith isn't one of the options. It is the only path to have God's commendation, to have his approval. And persevering faith receives God's approval. That's awesome. Lord, help us. One last point, third point. Persevering faith knows God's power. Persevering faith knows God's power. I meant to ask you guys if you could bring a copy of your resume this morning. Did anybody actually happen to bring a copy? I can feel them being emailed to me right now. I don't need it. I'm just joking. But, you know, you have, what's a resume? It's a record of what I've accomplished. It's a record of who I am. It's a summary of why I should be able to have this job, right? This whole thing is about the object of our faith, our eternal, matchless, sovereign God. And his resume is stellar. We're not going to unfold the whole thing, but this verse brings us one insight into it. Look at Hebrews 11, verse 3. 11:3. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. That's a pretty awesome point in the resume, I'm just telling you. You remember that day, right? Were you there that day? Yeah, me neither. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. Sometimes, what do they say? A picture's worth 1,000 words, right? And one of our pastors found a little video clip that just talks about God's creation and the scope of the universe. And so we're going to watch that together right now. Let's watch this.
To gain perspective with the aid of computer animation, let's now travel with the Earth to the Sun at 100 times the speed of light. From this view, we begin to appreciate the magnitude of our home star. Over 1 million Earths would fit inside the Sun. Yet our Sun is an average-sized star. Many stars in our own galaxy dwarf it. Arcturus is the fourth brightest star in the night sky. Though 200 trillion miles away, this orange giant is visible to the naked eye. By moving our Sun next to Arcturus, we can grasp its immensity. Arcturus is 100 times brighter, with a radius 20 times greater than the Sun's. Yet even Arcturus appears small when compared with the supergiant Betelgeuse. Betelgeuse has a radius 600 times that of our Sun. A reddish star, it shines a remarkable 60,000 times brighter than the Sun. However, even Betelgeuse is not the largest star in our galaxy. Several red supergiants in the Milky Way are even larger, some with a radius 1,500 times that of our Sun.
Well, one of the things in creation that I think really exhibits God's power is the power released in stars. The sun, it releases more energy in 1 second than a billion major cities on the earth, if there were a billion, would produce in a year. And that's just released in 1 second. You can imagine that. And of course, there are stars that are even more powerful than the sun. And just imagine all that power, all those stars, billions of stars in our own galaxy, billions of stars in other galaxies. And yet the Bible describes the creation of all that energy, all that power, with the single phrase, "He made the stars also."
When we consider that these ratios present only a sliver of our Creator's power, certainly we can agree with the psalmist when he exhorts, "Let all the earth fear the Lord." Of course, the stars reveal more than raw power. Without the light of the sun, all life on earth would soon perish. The sun's life-giving energy provides a constant reminder of our Creator's steadfast love, the God who shines his gift of light on all.
You ever feel kind of small? I thought I was kind of a big deal until I thought about being one of, what, 5-6 billion people on that little thing called Earth. Wow. Persevering faith knows God's power. Verse 3, by faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. This is our God. And let me just say it this way. Our faith has an unshakable foundation in the God who has chosen to reveal himself to us through the created world, through the truth of God's word in the Bible, and through his son, Jesus Christ. And now it's to us to respond by faith. Lord, I want to be your man. Lord, I want to be your woman. Lord, I want to honor you. Lord, I want to have an impact. I want to be that everyday person with uncommon faith in my great God. But I think it's actually like this. There are specific things that happen. Sometimes we choose them. Sometimes we allow them to happen that quench our faith. The good news is there are specific things that we can choose and prioritize that fuel our faith. And so I want to just spend our remaining time thinking about this together. I want to give you 5 just categories. And I want you to look for yourself in this and say, okay, now where is this happening or what needs to change in my life? I labeled it like this, 5 faith killers and 5 faith fillers, okay? So I'm going to give you a list of both. And I want you to look for like, all right, Lord, where can I make decisions of faith this week that can put me in a place of walking with you more consistently by faith? So here's faith killer number 1, filling your mind with things other than God's truth. That is a faith killer. I am probably not like you. You probably go to work on Monday mornings, don't you? Yeah, I don't. That's my day off because I work Saturday and I work Sunday. So Monday, recently, I was folding some laundry. It was pretty exciting. And I turned on the TV. I thought, oh, I wonder what's on TV on a Monday morning. That's a really bad decision. There's some news programs. That wasn't really great. There were some talk shows with wisdom being bantied about. I didn't actually find true wisdom in any of it. There was things being sold, things that would make my life better if I called this number or went on this website. Man, if I spent much more time filling my brain with what was coming through that morning, I would have been somewhere between discouraged and confused and exhausted. And I'm just telling you, the world continually sends us things. And one of the things that quenches my faith, kills my faith, is that my mind is full of things other than the truth of the Lord. And so what's the faith filler? You can guess it. Regular reading and listening to God's word. Having a pattern of, I need to fill my mind with what is true. Romans 10:17 says this. Where does faith come from? Listen to this verse. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. If you find your faith to be continually weak, keep filling it by putting God's truth into your life in a systematic way, personally and together when we come to church. Here's another faith killer, faithless friends. Now listen, I know you're probably, aren't we supposed to be salt and light? Aren't we supposed to have friends who don't know the Lord? Aren't we supposed to tell them about Jesus? For sure we should, and go after it with your whole heart. What I'm talking about is when the influence goes the other way. And I have a host of friends who don't love the Lord Jesus Christ. And so when the decision points come on what to do with this or that relationship or this season of life, if my input is coming from people who don't love the Lord Jesus Christ primarily, it's going to kill my faith. Now, what's a faith filler? Faith-filled friends. You're like, this is really complicated, Dave. Yeah, it's not that complicated, but we have to make decisions. I need people in my life who love the Lord Jesus Christ. I need people in my life who would tell me what God's word actually says. I need friends who will tell me what's true. Hebrews 10, it's in the same section of scripture where we're at. Hebrews 10, 24 says this, "Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." Get yourself some faith-filled friends. I was in touch with someone this week who hasn't been at church for a little while, and they're like, "I need to get back to church, and I need to find a place to serve." I'm like, "Yes, you do, because you got to get around God's people. You got to have people who are filling your faith and pointing you to Him." All right, here's a third faith killer, big one. Isolation. Really a big deal. We're warned about this in Scripture. One of the places is Proverbs 18:1 that says, "He who isolates himself breaks out." Sorry, let me say it again. Hebrews 18:1. "Whoever isolates himself seeks his own desire. He breaks out against all sound judgment." Can I just tell you, I think that's every one of us. I think left to myself, my own thinking, my isolation, I will go down a path apart from the Lord that is not healthy, that is not good. My thoughts will cycle, my behavior, temptation is strong when you're isolated, okay? That's a faith killer. Here's a faith filler. Friends who speak the truth. I don't like to be told that I'm not seeing it right, but I really appreciate it when it comes from the perspective of God's word. Dave, you need another perspective on that. You're missing something here. Friends who speak the truth. Ephesians 4:15 says this, "Rather, speaking the truth in love, we're to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ." All right, a couple more. Faith killer, sin and disobedience. You know, I just feel so far from the Lord. I feel like I hardly understand anything when I read His word. I can't speak for you, but I can just tell you, if sin has root in our hearts, if we know we're disobeying Him in various ways, you should not expect to hear His voice with clarity. It is an impediment to our relationship with God always. Now, the good news is Christ offers a different way, and it's through confession and repentance. Lord, that was not right. Lord, I need to ask you to forgive me. I need to call it what it is. I need to see it like you see it, Lord. And I've got to turn from that and turn to you. Do you know that 1 John 1:9, awesome verse, says, "If you confess your sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Major faith killer is my own unrepented sin. But in Christ and through confession and repentance, you'll see your faith grow like never before. Here's the last one. And this is really, it's very real, and I think it's for all of us. Supersizing my reasons for anxiety or worry. Now understand what I'm saying. By the way, does McDonald's still supersize things?
No.
Yeah, they probably never should have, really. Let's be honest. Yeah, so but what I mean is this. We look to real reasons to be concerned. Real things that can cause us to worry. But the problem is we make those things so huge. I don't know how this could ever change. One that comes to my mind, I remember this when one of my nephews was still in his mom's womb and they did some tests and they said, things aren't good and doesn't look like the brain is developing right and it just doesn't. And I remember praying and I remember, Lord, we trust you. And that young man is 17, 18 years old, healthy as could be. We can make the problem so huge by dwelling on it, and oh, this is the worst thing ever. Or, here's the faith filler, to right-size the greatness of our God.
Amen.
Do you understand who we worship and who we serve? Do you understand what He's able to do? Is anything too hard for the Lord? No, no. So a faith filler is this, to see God rightly for who he is. Psalms 86:8 is the reference there. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Now, we're in Hebrews 11, and we're not going to go any farther today, but if you read through it, and I would encourage you to read through it this week, you will find that whole hall of faith. All these people who did great things for God, was it because they were great? No, it's because God is great and they had an uncommon faith in the living God. Now, Scripture is complete. God is completely satisfied with the book he gave us. My name's not going to get in there, neither is yours. But do you know that our life can have an impact for the Lord? And our faith will be the determining factor of whether that happens or not. If I walk by faith, if I respond by faith, if I choose faith in the hardest moments, not faith in faith, not blind faith, faith in God, he's got what we need. Let's pray together. Lord, you're faithful. Even when we are not faithful, you are faithful because that is who you are. And Lord, we've come now to your word and we love this challenge because it's from you to respond to you by faith. Lord, I want to pray for anyone in this hearing of my voice who does not yet know Jesus Christ. Lord, would today be the day to turn from sin, to draw near to the living God. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for hope for eternity. Lord, help each one of us in the specifics where faith needs to be applied. Lord, help us to be people who receive our commendation because of our faith in what you have revealed. And Lord, help us to be those who persevere in faith because our hope is real and it is evidence of things not yet seen, but we trust you, Lord, and we trust you knowing that you are enough. Christ is everything to us. You're enough. Lord, we trust you. Help us to choose to trust you each moment of each day for your glory. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.